This video is for awareness only, and it does not give anybody who watches it permission or implied permission to enter or interfere with the railway infrastructure. The railway is an inherently dangerous environment, and this video is not intended also to be a substitution for any form of personal track safety course. As I've said, it's for information only. Please be safe and keep away from the railway infrastructure. The scope of this video covers England, Scotland, Wales, and the Isle of Wight. As Northern Ireland has a completely different rail network with a different regulatory ownership and operational model. So we're going to concentrate on mainline railways operated by Network Rail. This does not include any lines operated around by London Underground, even though there's very close interaction with this around London. We're not going to include any trams or light railway systems, but we are going to include more than 20,000 miles of track across England, Scotland and Wales operated by Network Rail. And this covers also 6,000 level crossings, 30,000 bridges and viaducts, and around 2,500 railway stations. Traditionally, goods and people were hauled by a horse and cart. But in poor ground conditions, the wheels of the carts got stuck. So rails, whether they be wood or later iron, were used to keep the wheels out of the mud. And that started the very first kind of railway. And the oldest known human or animal-hauled railways date back to the 6th century BC in Greece. But modern rail transport commenced in the United Kingdom in Great Britain with the development of the steam locomotive, when Richard Trevithick ran a steam locomotive for an ironworks. Then, between the 6th and 14th of October 1829, the Rainhill trials were run. And this was an important condition near Liverpool to test which locomotive would run on the nearly completed Liverpool and Manchester Railway. And George Stephenson's famous Rocket locomotive was the only locomotive to complete the trials and declared the winner. There was a boom in the railway industry, and in 1846, in Great Britain, there were 272 different railways. And later and over time, these become amalgamated into larger companies. But in 1921, there was the Railways Act, also known as the Grouping Act, and this created what is known as the Big Four railway companies, namely the Great Western, London North Eastern Railway, London Midland and Scottish Railway, and the Southern Railway. After World War II, the Transport Act of 1947 caused nationalisation of the private railway companies, and British Transport Commission took control of British Railways. British Railways were split into 6 different regions. Under the Transport Act of 1962, British Railways Board split from the British Transport Commission to become its own body, and this later became British Rail. Beeching cuts, also known as the Beeching Acts, was a plan to increase the railway's efficiency, and the plan was outlined in 2 reports. In 1963, the report The Reshaping of British Railways, and in 1965, The Development of the Major Railway Trunk Routes. Both were written by Richard Beeching and published by British Railways Board. At the time, there was 18,000 miles, which is 29,000 kilometres, of railways in Great Britain. And Beeching recommended that 6,000 miles, that's 9,700 kilometres, mostly rural and industrial railway lines, should be closed entirely. As a result of this, roughly 5,000 miles of track were closed and 2,300 stations were axed starting in the 1960s, and most of these were in rural areas.
Historically, Richard Beeching is seen as being a divisive character. At the end of the day, he did what he was instructed, which was to reduce the size of the rail network. I've mentioned the reshaping of British railways, and this is a facsimile of the book that was published. It's quite a dry read. Lots of text and tables and charts. What is interesting is some of the maps in the back. If you look at map number 9, in red is where all stopping services are to be withdrawn, and the black lines is where all passenger services are to be withdrawn. So you've got Settle to Carlisle being shut, but look, north of Scotland, no railway lines. Stopping passenger services on the East Coast Main Line. Some of these rail lines did close, such as this one over the Scottish borders, but in the 2000s, that's been restored. So there is an appetite, as of 2022, to restore some of the lines closed by Beeching. The plan was to have bustitution instead of railways, where buses would take the place of trains. This did not work, it really didn't, and when the buses were introduced, they made losses as well and were cancelled. But this is quite a nice historical copy to have. And there's lots of diagrams on coal traffic and the various statistics collected were made into graphs, which at the time must have been quite a manual exercise. But going back to Beeching, he was a refreshing change to the rail network. Beeching was very approachable and surprised many how the person at the top of the organisation treated all the workers under him with great respect and friendliness, and was very friendly to junior staff members in the office. So it was a breath of fresh air. He did not come from a railway background, and he basically brought the cycle that you had to come from the railway or probably the military to work for British Railways and be part of the executive. He was actually from ICI. So I think Beeching is a very split character historically, but a very important character. Whilst he strove to modernise the railways didn't want to modernise themselves.
As time went on, British Rail operated under very similar structures as the Big Four railway companies. There was some rationalisation where the North Eastern and Eastern British Rail regions become just the Eastern region, but the way the railways was run hadn't changed much since the days of the Big Four. People now forget how big an organisation British Rail was, and it owned organisations such as British Rail Engineering Ltd or BREL, which made trains and rolling stock. It operated ships and ferries with SeaLink. It even operated hovercraft services via SeaSpeed. It had its own research departments. It had its own parcels courier service via Red Star, and all the catering was in-house via Travellers Fare, and it also owned lots of property and also some quite large city centre hotels. But things were divided very regionally until sectorisation come on. And this is where British Rail reorganised itself, not just on regional grounds, but as individual business units. And these business units included Intercity, Network South East for all commuter lines feeding into London, regional railways, specialist freight sectors, and rail express services for parcels and rail traffic, and specialist train services such as charter hire and also the Royal Train. But in the 1990s, came privatisation. The deregulation of the railway was initiated by the European Union in Directive 91440 in 1991. And the British government of the time decided to split responsibility of infrastructure from the trains. So one organisation would run the infrastructure and other organisations would run the trains that ran on the infrastructure. So the railway was completely privatised, the infrastructure was owned by a private company called Railtrack, and trains were operated by a number of private franchises that bid to run on the lines. All maintenance on Railtrack infrastructure was carried out by regional infrastructure maintenance companies and their subcontractors. Railtrack did not carry out any engineering activities itself. In effect, it was an asset management company. Similar to maintenance, renewals and projects were contracted out, and this used many subcontract organisations. Under the privatisation of the trains, the ownership of them went to three private rolling stock leasing companies called Roscoes, and these would lease trains to the franchisee who'd been awarded operation of a specific route. Passenger trains were operated by 25 train operating companies known as TOCs. And freight trains were operated by 5 freight train operators plus the nationalised Direct Rail Services. DRS was created by the nationalised British Nuclear Fuels Limited to take over British Rail's handling of nuclear material, which ownership of which transferred to the Nuclear Decommissioning Authority in 2005. But it doesn't just do nuclear haulage now, it does general railway freight haulage and also haulage for passenger services. So passenger trains would be allocated individual train paths under regional franchises, and freight trains would also be allocated train paths. If franchises were run, private companies bid from the government for specific services via a tender process. The resulting franchise would be let for specific routes on specific services, and there'd be premiums or subsidy to or from the government depending on the franchise and depending on the performance of that franchise. At the end of the franchise period, there'd be a new tender process and the franchise will be terminated or extended under a new franchise. There were 2 bad rail accidents, the Southall rail crash in 1997 and the Ladbroke Grove rail crash in 1999. And this called into question whether the fragmentation into many companies of the railway network had an effect on safety and maintenance performance. In 1999, the company's share price started to fall. However, the Hatfield rail crash in 2000, caused by metal fatigue in the rails, derailed a Great Northeastern Railway Intercity 225 train at approximately 115 miles an hour, and tragically, 4 people were killed and more than 70 injured. This added to spiralling increases in the cost to modernise the West Coast Main Line. Railtrack went from profit to loss, and the government of the time placed Railtrack PLC into railway administration. Railtrack shares, which were once as high as £17.68, were suspended at £2.80 in 2001 before railway administration. A government-owned company, which later became part of the public sector, called Network Rail, took over the responsibilities of Railtrack, and then took over later the responsibility of Railtrack's private maintenance contractors. Brings us to the structure of Britain's railways today. Today, Network Rail is the owner and operator and maintainer of the railway infrastructure. And yes, they do use some contractors, but all maintenance activities are delivered by Network Rail. Many renewals and projects are contracted out to private operators still though. In terms of trains, there's about 9 rolling stock leasing companies, there's 20 train operating companies, and about 7 freight train operators. How all this is organised? The UK Parliament have a regulator for the rail industry called the Office of Rail and Road, and this includes the train operators. There's railway safety bodies, including British Transport Police, the Health and Safety Executive, the Rail Accident Investigation Branch, and the Rail Safety Standards Board. As I said, the train operators are split into franchise TOCs, open access train operating companies which operate on train paths in between franchise routes and franchise services, and Eurostar, which is classed as an open access operator. The funders for the industry are the Departments of Transport, Transport Scotland, the Welsh Government, and regionally, Passenger Transport Executives. However, due to the COVID-19 pandemic and the severe downturn in passenger rail use, in March 2020, franchises were suspended, and in September 2020, all franchises were scrapped and all franchise holders given management contracts. In May 2020, Great British Railways was announced, and please see our video about GBR, with Great British Railway operations planned to start in 2023. Great British Railways will be operating on similar regional lines to Network Rail, but with the North Eastern and Eastern regions merged, North Wales going from Network Rail London Midland region to Western and Wales, and some slight changes along the boundary between Midland and Eastern. There is much funding available to improve the railways. HS2 is being built. The Integrated Rail Plan, which, whilst it cuts some of HS2 off and doesn't build a new line on the eastern section completely, it does benefit some other cities such as Nottingham and Derby. We hope you've enjoyed today's video. This is the first of a series of rail videos, so if you've enjoyed it, please subscribe and please click on the little bell on YouTube as not to miss out on our further videos. And thanks for watching, and goodbye.
Some of this series of videos will have bonus videos published. The first one is called Take Possession, and it's a very sobering reminisce on what happens when possession, which is when the engineer takes over possession of the railway infrastructure to carry engineering work from the signaller, and unfortunately things can go wrong. And I want you just to watch the bonus video and just fully understand how dangerous the railway infrastructure actually is.